everybody. You're watching Mr. Fugu Data Science. Today, we're going to parse some Google Timeline JSON data. Thank you to the recent subscriber who brought this to my attention and wanted to see an example of parsing this. Now, let's do some importing. Let's call in pandas JSON, date time, collections, OS, and at this point, we're not using regular expression. So the first thing that was brought to my attention, how do you actually search for files within a directory? Depending on what circumstance you have or how you want to solve this problem, you could use a command line utility. You can create a function that does this. You could use grep. Just depends on what you're trying to do or if you're trying to create like an input statement. But nevertheless, I have this function where I'm walking through my current directory and I have these three parameters, P, N, and F. P will show your file path for the current directory. N is a list of your files. F will be a list of string names of those files. This top A right here will give you the files as a list, if I'm correct, and then the bottom one will be the actual file name. The portion that I have here would be if you knew all of the columns or header information for your data, if it was like a CSV file, you could just take this off, put a comma, and add this in, for instance. We can also add a separate argument here or parameter that you can call after the fact, which will allow us to either look at the file path, we can get the data which is unformatted, or we could use no arguments and basically print off the raw data that we see here, all right? I decided for time constraints not to cover the regular expressions of parsing these data if you had the file names, but I left two links to get you started or get some ideas. The data that we have will look like this, where we have an outer portion, which is a timeline object, and then a list of dictionaries covering various key value pairs. There's a few things that we need to do. Let's look at what is going on here by starting with putting this into a data frame and seeing what it looks like. Okay, so we see that we have dictionaries with values, which are more dictionaries, which is another value, which is another dictionary. So one way that we can look at this is using JSON normalize to flatten these data out and do some further investigation. So let's take the timeline object that we have, which is the outermost part, and let's go inside of that. Okay, what's that going to give me? The same thing, right? But here's where we got to start doing some stuff. Let's convert this to a JSON object. Let's do orient equals records due to the formatting. So then we converted this into a string. So now we do further processing where we're going to say JSON.loads with an S for JSON.load as a string. So we're getting closer to what we need. Then we need to call our JSON normalize and encapsulate all of this. And that's going to give us our flattening of our data. So we're on the right track. Okay. We need to do some processing now. For instance, this timestamp data, we need to do some converting. We need to handle the NaN values. We will also have to go inside of this list of JSON or list of dictionaries. So we have a few of those going on. All right. So there's a lot that we have to deal with. So let's make a variable and let's just call it extended DF, I guess. Now, I was told from the subscriber that these were the particular columns that we needed. And if you notice the dot notation, this is due to the fact that you have nesting and it's saying we're starting from the outer, we're going inner, innermost. That's what's going on with this. So we need to now do some parsing of these columns. So let's call this df star since we're basically starting from nowhere. And calling in the df that we had. And in particular, I want to take all rows, but with the columns for the desired variables. And then I would like to, out of curiosity, see what the data types are for these data. Alrighty. After some frustration, I got this fixed. I don't know what was wrong, but I was curious on seeing what the data types were for this to figure out how I'm going to start manipulating these data. So it looks like most of these are objects, so you can have lists or strings and things like that. We can explode the columns to get into our nested data, which will basically take the list of whatever you have, could be strings or dictionaries, and flattens it all out. And this could be very useful if you don't mind having really long data, which means that you have less columns. And depending on the circumstance, that's better. But you're gonna notice that we're going to have a lot of duplicate values. So we need to figure out what we're going to do df explode on. So that's, let's do the df explode, and let's do that on the particular column that we have, which is our nested data. Let's see what that looks like. Okay, so what do we really open up? So this is what we took, and then if we scroll over, So this is what we took, and we took away the list outside of it. Now we're left with the dictionaries that we need to take care of. So just like we did with the other stuff, we got to do the two JSON, orient that, and do the same things as before. We have to, from there, do the JSON.loads. We need to close that off. And then we're going to do the normalize. Let's make sure that's closed out properly. Let's look at it now. And what's going on here? Well, we flattened everything out. But you have these right here. So these are your, this is the column that you had that was flattened out with its probability that was inside of that list of dictionaries. And now for each entry that was a dictionary with its key and its value will be split into new rows. All right. So if we wanted to see what the data looked like, now we have 102 rows. Originally we had 6 rows. So it expanded it quite a bit. And if you count these data, each one of the activities, there's 33 of them, and you have 3 rows that had activities, which would be 99, and then you had 3 additional rows that had NaN values, which are only counted once, which will give you 102. Now, if we want columns and not a bunch of rows, that's why this is going to take quite a bit of work, more than I expected. Let's do our timestamp stuff first. Oh, hold on. Back up. I almost forgot something. To do these timestamp data after I used the explode, there was an issue. For instance, I did the timestamp first, then I ran the explode and expanded it, but this formatting was overwritten and provided only the original format instead of the date timestamp that I fixed. So that's one thing to focus on. If you need your data to look like this, run the explode first, then do the timestamp. If you're not going to use this formatting, don't worry about it, but that's the distinction you need to be aware of. So we need to do timestamp for these particular columns. We'll have this designation right here. And as a disclaimer, I'm going to call this in my particular way instead of doing the .loc or .iloc to just pull specific columns or rows. Instead, I'm going to do this method because I wanted to suggest if you are in a circumstance with many columns that you just can't read all of them to do some string matching based on certain criteria. So let's iterate inside of our data frame, and we need to call a condition, and we're going to do a string find for anything that's a timestamp. You're using regular expressions, you could take care of this, and we're going to do this greater than zero, because when it's doing the string find, it'll return a value, and let's say it returned 30. That would mean that at position 30, this is starting. If it returned a -1, then it means that it wasn't there. And then this just return our I. And then if you were to use this else statement, it would just preserve basically how it's indexed. We're going to look at that real quick if we want. Okay, that's going to cause issues. Okay, we'll look at it at the end. That's fine. So let's deal with this filling our data frame variable. And I'm going to call in my location of all columns with the new column names. But I want to fill these NA values with zeros. I'm changing the data type to numeric since it was not. I'm going to use a default dictionary where the values will be lists. And now we need to do some iterating. So let's look inside of our DF, convert it to a dictionary, and then we're going to take all the items in it, our key value pairs, and then I need to iterate through and take our first parameter and do values. And then what do we have to do? Make a comparison to see if J equals 0. And if it does, we will then take our default dictionary and append those values of nothing, or we could just say nada. Otherwise, what happens? We're going to fill it with the timestamp information. And that's going to be the date time from timestamp. And then you're going to notice something interesting here. Why am I dividing by 1,000? Because I have the milliseconds for these data. And if you don't have this, it's going to give you a value error because you're out of the range. And there we go. We got our timestamp information all the way up to the millisecond. You can get rid of that. And for the processing, just depends on what you need. I replaced all the empty values with nadas. And we'll see what else do we have to format. We can get rid of the NaN value for distance, change that to zeros. We can deal with the addresses if we felt like it. What else do we have? So we're doing pretty good. So I take care of the confidence and the activity distance. And I just fill both of those columns with NA. And then I just replace those values with the columns so I don't have to do any weird aliasing and get this print out. Then I did some more converting and just put in nope on the activities that we're going to process. Let were NaN, and I'm replacing that with nope. From there, we need to extract this column so we can do some processing for it. So I did the same stuff we did before, convert it to JSON, explode it, take it as a string, looking through it. But why am I going through this right here? Well, because I'm interested in how I could start manipulating these data, because it's nested, it's in a list, it had formatting that was a little funky where you had some values that were NaN for rows, some that were just list of dictionaries, and formatting this so I could parse it correctly into columns was a little challenging, so I had to do some manipulation. That's why I was curious on what these data actually look like. So what I did was I created a trick so I could have a little hack where I'm going to fill every string with this formatting, which will be the same as the list that we have for our nested data. But instead, all the values are going to be nada. And then I'm going to do this for the length of the data, right? I only took the first example because I know that each one of them contains at max, and they're all the same length, 33 individual activities that people can do. So I'm calling this a hack, and here's what we got to do. We got a lot of stuff to code for this one. So I need to iterate in the data frame and find the activities that we need. Let's put that into a list of values, and then we're going to append what we call trick, which is this, but when? We need to append this if we have a type of string for our iterator. Otherwise, we have the data formatting that we actually need, and we just append that directly in. I need to use these data and put them into a data frame, and I take that, we'll see what this looks like, and now we have a format we can use JSON normalize with. So we use JSON normalize, flatten everything out, and here's what it looks like. But I have the actual activity and I have the probability of that occurring. But how do I further process this so I can actually take just this as basically my key and take this as my value, all right? But also, how do I align this with having a whole row full of nadas? And that was really messing with me. So I did a little bit of trickery here, and you could figure out this on your own if you were even cared or were inclined to do so. But here's what I did to make it easier upon myself. I'm saying if I find some string with the activity and it's actually there, then let's just append our activity. Otherwise, we're going to append the probability value of I. So then what's going on? We're basically separating activities and probabilities so we can zip them together, all right? So what's going on next? I need to now iterate in the activity probability combined, but I need to now call my probabilities as values, and I'm going to now append those, and I need to do almost the same thing here. So let's do some cutting and pasting, and I could have made this into a function. So we're storing that now. creating our default dictionary list. And then I'm going to iterate through each one of these. And so this will be my probability. But I'm not going to use a pen. I'm going to extend this. So it's just one long list. And I'm going to do the same thing for the activities. And then what? Let's put all these together where I'm zipping these, my U and my V. And I will call my activity and create my dictionary list with my keys and my values as a list. If I did this correctly. Uh-oh, I noticed I messed up and wasn't considering what I did. What I needed to do here is basically, I wanted to create the activities and multiply the 33 activities times the amount of rows that I have so I could append or zip together the, if I have 33 entries for each row, I have 6 rows, I want to have 33 of these match with all the values in my rows so we can get it to look good. Okay, hack is correct. All right. Then, no, that's correct. This wasn't touched. That should be correct. We'll look at prob and act. Act is not correct. There we are. There's my error. Now we converted it. Okay. This is looking kind of not right. Okay. Oh, that's not right, is that? No. So, extend I. There we are. So I don't know what's going on with that, but it took so long to get this fixed. Anyway, this is what the format will look like. So it's creating your key and then all the values and it's matching it up for your rows. So now we have our data frame. Everything looks like it's hunky-dory and works out perfectly. We have to fix the column names. What I did was on the first occurrence of a dot, I split. I took the last element of each nested list, appended that, or took it through my list comprehension, changed the column names. Now we have our names, which are changed. You can also get rid of this old column since you don't need it anymore and you expanded, but it was just here just to show you. We need to further do the concatenation and put everything together. So our data that we just changed the names with and the new data that we expanded on here. And that'll be the conclusion of this video. I'd like to say thank you for watching. I hope this brought utility to someone. Please like, share, and subscribe. And if you subscribe, turn on that notification bell. Thank you to the recent viewers and subscribers. I greatly appreciate it. And those who have been going on my GitHub. If you have any questions, comments, or concerns, let me know. Or if you have any content you would like to see, leave a comment. Have a good one. Bye.